Good morning, everyone. So my name is CJ Fury. I'm the vicar at Christ Lutheran Church down in downtown Denver. And since Zach is graduating up at MLC this weekend, Pastor asked me if I would come and guest preach. So some of you might know what a vicar is. Some of you might not. What a vicar is it's really, I'm a seminary student. So I'm training to be a pastor. And a part of our training is we get sent out to a church to be there for a year and to learn from a pastor. My pastor is Paul Biedenbender. To learn from him, what's it like to be a pastor? So it's kind of like an internship, I guess, is a way that I could describe it. And so that's where I am right now in my studies. But here this morning, I am more than blessed and privileged to be here with you this morning. And I've already met a few guests that are with us. It really is a blessing to have you guests with us as well. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Lord is my strength and my defense. He has become my salvation. The Lord's right hand is lifted high. The Lord's right hand has done mighty things. I will not die, but live, and will proclaim what the Lord has done. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Let us confess our sins to the Lord. Holy God, gracious Father, I am sinful by nature and have sinned against you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have not loved you with my whole heart. I have not loved others as I should. I deserve your punishment both now and forever. But Jesus, my Savior, paid for my sins with his innocent suffering and death. Trusting in him, I pray, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. Our gracious Father in heaven has been merciful to us. He sent his only Son, Jesus Christ, who gave his life as the atoning sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. O God, you formed the minds of your faithful people into a single will. Make us love what you command and desire what you promise, that among the many changes of this world, our hearts may ever yearn for the lasting joys of heaven. Through your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This morning we read from Acts chapter 8, and we see Peter again speaking to the crowd. And Peter, he's talking about the stone that the builders rejected. That stone that the builders rejected is Christ. Because you see, for you and I, Christ, he's that cornerstone. He's the one who sets everything for us in our lives, and we'll talk about this more in the sermon, but he is the only one, the only way that we can be strong, the only way that we can survive, the only way that we can go home to heaven. We read from Acts chapter 4. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, "Rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. Jesus is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the cornerstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And now we'll have our children's message. So you guys can come just sit right here in the front. The pastor left me a note of what I'm supposed to do during the children's message, other than give the children's message, but I can't remember. So if I do something that's weird, can you guys not hold it against me if I do something that's weird? Okay, thank you. But I want to ask you guys, what's the place that you think you go to the most, other than your house? Maybe it's school. Maybe you really love Jesus, and so you come to church every day. No, that's okay. I don't even go to church every day. But do you guys think you go to school the most? Or is there another place that maybe you go to a lot? You go to school a lot? Yeah, I know. But that's almost over, right? Yeah, but it's probably school, right? You guys probably go to school every day of the week. And so it's okay if the answer is no, but I want to ask you guys, do you know the way home from school? Thankfully, we know that mom and dad know the way, right? So that we can drive home and get there safe. But in a couple years, and maybe not yet, but in a couple years, especially if you guys keep on going to the same school, eventually, when you drive home from school, you're just going to know it. You're just going to know the way. And today Jesus, he says to you, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And so maybe you don't know the way home to school, but let me ask you this. Do you guys know the way home to heaven? Who is he? What's his name? Jesus, right? Even you guys who don't even know how to drive home from school, you know how to drive home. Well, not drive, but you know how to get home in heaven. It's Jesus. Jesus, because he loves you so much that he died for you to take away all your sins, that he rose from the dead for you so that you can live in your home in heaven with him. And so we might not always know the way home to our house here in this world, but you guys definitely know your way home to heaven. It's Jesus. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for being our way home. Thank you, Jesus, for being the one who loved all of us so much that you left your home in heaven to come and save us. Always remind us, Jesus, no matter what is going on in life, that we know the way home, and it's through you. Amen. All right, now here's the part where I might do something weird. I don't know what happens next. Oh, are there pamphlets? Sadly, I don't. Maybe they're somewhere around here. I should have been better prepared. I apologize. Let me look. Yeah. Actually, tell my pastor. He can write it down on my report. No, but. So you guys can go back and sit down. I'm sorry, no pamphlets this morning. Now we'll come together with our gospel acclamation. Alleluia, alleluia. I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Alleluia. And so we'll read our gospel from John chapter 14. These words will also be the basis for our sermon this morning. Jesus says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him." Philip said, "Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us." Jesus answered, "Don't you know me, Philip, even after I have been among you such a long time? Anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves." The gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ. We'll sing "Welcome, Happy Morning." So there are some things in life that you just know. Right? You just know the day you were born. You know when your birthday is. Someone could ask you, hey, when's your birthday? And you can just answer like that without even hardly thinking about it. Or maybe you just know your own cell phone number. And hopefully, you just know the birthdays of everyone in your family, but sometimes, you know, we forget those even. But the point is that there are things in life that you just know. Things in life that you hardly even have to think about. It's like a knee-jerk reaction. You just know them. And one of those things that we just know is how to get home. Right? I can be in just about any area in Denver, and even up in Boulder. My wife and I, we like to come up here and hike and go to different restaurants and such. And so even from Boulder, I know that if I can reach this landmark or reach 36 or reach 25 or reach this street, that from then on, I just know the way home. I can go ahead and I can turn off my GPS and I'm safe and I know that I'm going to make it home. You just know the way home. And sometimes we know the way home so well that we're driving home and we're sort of stuck on autopilot. Right? Has that ever happened to anyone? Where you drive home and all of a sudden I'm pulling into my driveway or I'm pulling into the parking lot of my apartment and I think to myself, how did I get here? Or I think to myself, wow, I was not thinking about the drive that whole ride. I was daydreaming about something else, or I was thinking about something else, which, by the way, is not a great thing, right? It's not good for us to be driving down the road at high speeds, not thinking about driving, but thinking about something else. But if you've ever driven before, you know that sometimes you can be stuck on autopilot on the way home. That's dangerous. But it's also dangerous when we're stuck on autopilot on our way home in terms of our faith, right? I wouldn't ever want to get to heaven and see Jesus and think to myself, boy, how did I get here? I wouldn't ever want to get to heaven and think to myself, wow, I really wasn't thinking along the way. Now, here this morning, we see Jesus having this conversation with his disciples, right? And here in John chapter 14, this is one of the last conversations that Jesus had with them before he died. It's the night that he was betrayed. It's that Maundy Thursday evening before Good Friday. And it wasn't just that the disciples were somehow stuck on autopilot. It wasn't just that they were going through the motions. Actually, it was kind of the opposite. Here in these words, Jesus, he's describing to them about the heavenly home that's prepared for them, that he's going to go and prepare for them. He's talking to them about his Father, and they're getting all excited about the mansions of heaven, and they're getting all excited about seeing the Father one day, that they weren't just on autopilot on the way home. It's that they completely look past the way home. They knew the way home. The way home was sitting right in front of them. They were so excited and so excited about all these different things that he was talking about that they looked right past the way. And so Thomas, he asked Jesus, Lord, we don't know where you're going. So how can we know the way? And what's interesting is if you look at that in verse 5, just before that, Jesus says to them, you know the way to where I'm going. So Jesus says to his disciples, you know the way to where I'm going. And Thomas pipes up and he says, I don't know the way. But not only does he say that he doesn't know the way, Thomas, for some reason, even though he had been with Jesus for years, even though Jesus had told them that the Son of Man needed to suffer and to die, and that he needed to return to his father, Thomas, and the disciples, they still didn't quite get it. But Jesus, we know him as a God of compassion and a God of faithful love. And so just as he shows us love and compassion, he does the same thing to his disciples. So even when Thomas asks this foolish question, Jesus responds, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. Those are beautiful words of comfort. Those are beautiful words of promise. But it still isn't quite clicking. And so Philip, he butts in and he says, Lord, show us the Father and that will be enough. Show us the Father and that will be enough for us. And that question sounds even more silly after what Jesus says to Philip. He says, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I've been with you for such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? Show us the Father, Jesus, and that will be enough. Really? Here he is. There he was, sitting in front of them. There he was. He had been with them at this point for 2 or 3 years, teaching them and doing miracles in front of them. Show us the Father, Jesus, and that'll be enough for us. There he is in front of you. What are our attitudes towards the way? What's our attitude towards knowing the way? Because Jesus doesn't just say to his disciples, you know the way, I am the way. This morning he says to you, you know the way, I am the way. And so when we're searching for answers in life, when we're seeking guidance, when we're trying to find the way, those situations can be very real and difficult, can't they? God, show me the way. Show me the way, as it seems like for months I've just been battling my mental health. Lord, show me the way as I'm stuck in this rut of sadness or anxiety and depression, and I can't find a way out. Lord, show me the way. Lord, show me the way when for some reason my daughter just doesn't want to listen to me. Lord, show me the way when my husband's just been mistreating me. Show me the way when my sister refuses to even speak to me. Show me the way. Or maybe it's the way when we've prayed for something again and again. And again, Lord, show me the way as I have lifted this prayer before you time and time again. Show me the way as I've begged you, I've desperately asked you for this or that thing. Lord, please show me the way. And I want to clarify, it's not at all a bad thing to ask the Lord in prayer for guidance. I'm not here at all to say that we shouldn't pray to the Lord and say, Lord, show me the way. Lord, give me some direction with this thing that I'm going through in life. Show me the way that I can walk in the light of your word. Show me the way. That's a beautiful prayer. But I think that we get so caught up in the outcome of the way. I think that we can get so caught up in the final destination, that thing that we're longing for, that we're like Philip and we're like Thomas. And the way, he's sitting right in front of us. He's standing right before our eyes and we look right past him. Jesus, he's shown us the way. And it's true that as I'm going through this unique situation in life, or as I'm praying for this unique thing, that I might want guidance, that I might want understanding, that I might want clarity. But we have a Jesus who says, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. And so as we pray, Lord, show me the way, we pray confidently. Because we already know exactly what that way is. We know who he is. We know what he's done for us. We know that the guidance that he gives us by the light of his word. And so we look to him. We look to him and say, Lord, show me the way. Knowing that your will be done no matter what happens in my life. We look to him and we say, Lord, show me the way. Knowing that he has already made a way for us through the love that he's shown us. There are times where we're tempted to weigh the things of this life over our heavenly home. There are times when we are tempted to doubt the truth of God's word because maybe our circumstances in this life aren't ideal. There are times where we aren't focused on the way to our heavenly home, but our mind is focused on other things. And in those times, that's where Jesus says to us in his word, I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. Have faith in God. Believe in God and believe in me. In my Father's house, there are many rooms. Jesus, when we fix our eyes away from him, when we're so focused on the thing that is beyond him, when we're forgetting to just remember the way, that's when he shows us in his word, I am the way. You know the way. In this conversation that Jesus had with his disciples, it wasn't just that he wanted to tell them about all these amazing things before he died. So it wasn't just that Jesus wanted to say, hey, you know, tomorrow's going to be really hard, but just so you know, there are these things that are really awesome. My Father's house, mansions, rooms in my Father's house prepared for you. That those of you who have seen me have seen the Father, and you're going to be there with me someday. He wasn't just telling them these things to get them excited. But look at how he starts this conversation. He says, do not let your hearts be troubled. Jesus says, you know the way. And it's not just knowing the way in terms of, well, I know that someday, one day, I'm just going to be in heaven and it's going to be the best thing in the world. That's true. But why is Jesus reminding us that we know the way? Why is Jesus reminding us of this glorious home that we have in heaven? It's so that we remember the way in the middle of the things that trouble our hearts in this life. And we find that peace and we find that hope in those troubling times through our faith. Right, Jesus, he didn't just say, do not let your hearts be troubled, as if he was scolding his disciples, as if he was yelling at them, how could you let your hearts be troubled? No, Jesus, he knows that we are going to go through troubles in this life. Jesus, he knows that there are going to be things that are extremely difficult. And he knows that those things that are difficult, that they're going to affect us. But what else does he say? He says, believe in God. Believe in me. Jesus, he's grabbing us by the shoulders and saying, look to me and trust. He's grabbing us by the shoulders and saying, look at my Father in heaven and trust in him. Trust in the love that he has shown you. By the way that he made a way for you through his death on the cross, his payment for sins, and his life, his resurrection from the dead. Look to him and trust in that precious word of God. He says, I am the way and the truth, and we know that that truth is found nowhere else but in his word. That word that not only is true for us, but that word that is the lamp for our feet and the light for our path. That word that guides us even along a troubling way in this life. Look to him and find your life. Not just purpose and meaning in this life, although that's where we find that in him, but also the life to come, the life forever in a special place prepared for you in the heavenly home that waits for us. And there is real safety and security in knowing that heavenly home that's waiting for us. And so you think about your house, right? Just for now, right now, think about your own home. And there is true safety and true comfortability with our own houses, right? We feel safe in our houses because we know our neighbors. And we're familiar with our neighborhood. And we know all the different steps and measures that we've taken to make sure that our house, our homes, our belongings, and our families are safe, right? I know the different locks that I have. I know maybe it's a security system that you have. For me, when I moved to Colorado, I bought a puppy, and so she's my security blanket. But you know, when you're at home, that you have this sense of security. And you also know that when you're at home, you're most likely more comfortable, right? Who doesn't like to sleep in their own bed? Who doesn't like to cook in their own kitchen? Who doesn't like to sit on their own sofa and watch TV? We prefer all those things other than doing them elsewhere because we're familiar with our own home. There's a sense of familiarity that gives us security and comfort when it comes to our houses. Now, this might sound silly and seem to make no sense, but none of that would matter if I didn't know how to get home. Cooking in my own kitchen, and watching TV on my own couch, and sleeping in my own bed, and feeling safe because I know my surroundings. None of that would matter, even a little bit, if I had no idea how to drive home. You know the way home. You know the way home. You know that Jesus, he is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. You know the way home, and you know that in Jesus, your way home is secure. Not because your faith is so strong. Not because you're able to trust in his promises better than other people. But because of the object of your faith. Because of who he is. And because of what he has done for you. You know the way home. You are familiar with the way home. That's why you come here on Sundays. And maybe it's not me, but maybe it's Pastor, and he's reminding you of those same precious promises of God week in and week out. There's a reason why we're reminded of these promises so often, so that they're familiar to us, so that we have that sense of security and that sense of comfortability in knowing we know the way home. There are things in life that you just know, right? Things in life that you don't even have to think about. You know the way home. I'm not just talking about leaving church this morning and driving home. By God's grace, you know the way to your heavenly home. He has made it abundantly clear to you. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. You know the one who made a way home by winning for you the forgiveness of all of your sins through his sacrifice on the cross for you. You know the one who shone the way home, the one who makes clear the way home through the truth that he's given to us in his word. And you know the one who's prepared a home for you in heaven, the one who has given you life, and he has made that home in heaven absolutely secure through his resurrection from the dead. Amen. This time, I'll just remind you that our offering plates are there in the back. So if you would like to give an offering this morning, please just place your offering in the plates. For those of you who are visiting us this morning, please do not feel obligated to give. This time we're going to have a few moments of meditation and prayer. So during this time, if you would please just meditate on the message, on God's word for you this morning and what that means for you. And we're also going to ask that at this time, please fill out a connection card. You may fill out as much information on that connection card as you're comfortable with, but especially if you're a guest and visitor with us this morning, we'd ask that you would go ahead and fill one of those out. Thank you. Before we pray, are there any special prayer requests this morning? Yeah.
If we could just do a prayer for all the MLC graduates who were assigned yesterday.
Yep, absolutely. And we'll maybe say a special prayer for Jack or for Zach. Not Jack, for Zach. But yeah, absolutely. Anything else? All right. Let's go to our God in prayer. Lord God, we come to you knowing that we are sinners who at times veer our eyes off of the way. That whether we're going through this life on autopilot or sometimes we completely look past the way, that we struggle to be reminded of the peace and the hope and the security and comfortability that we have in you as our way, truth, and life. Lord, we thank you for your forgiveness, for times like this where we fail. And we ask that, you would strengthen us, strengthen our hearts to always look to you, Jesus, as our way. Look to you as the one who has paid the price for our sins, the one who has won life forever in heaven by your resurrection. And Lord, as we hear this message of salvation, we also pray that, this message of salvation would go out to the whole world. We pray that, you would provide workers in your harvest field, that you would provide people to share that good news of Jesus with all this world. And so we thank you, Lord, for those gifts in the graduates at Martin Luther College who received calls into your ministry just yesterday. Lord, we also pray for the graduates who are moving on to the seminary. We pray that you would continue to give them eagerness and desire to serve you in your kingdom. Be with those graduates who just got called. If there are fears, calm those fears with your love. If there are doubts, settle those doubts with your truth. Lord, remind all of those graduates that wherever they go, wherever you take them, that you are always with them, and your word and your truth for them never fails. Lord, we especially pray for Zach, for Pastor's son Zach, as he moves on to the seminary. We pray for his fiance and, her undertaking of this new call that she has. We also pray for their wedding coming up and, that all things go smoothly with that. Lord, be with Zach. Guide him by your word as he undertakes the task of studying your word every day at the seminary. Lord, we ask all these things knowing that you hear us, knowing that you love us, and then knowing that your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. We pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We'll sing our final hymn, Alleluia, Let Praises Ring.
Thank you.
Morning again to everyone. It truly is a privilege and a neat experience for me to come out to your church and serve you this morning. So thank you. Thank you again to all of our guests and visitors that are with us this morning. So I believe there's coffee in the back. I don't know a lot about that, but I think it's there. We are going to have Bible study at 10:30 this morning, or maybe even a little before. But again, I'm the vicar and I'm doing things weird. We're going to have Bible study here this morning in the church. There was an issue that was my fault with copies. So we're going to have the Bible study up on this TV. So hopefully that will make do. And does anyone else have any other announcements? Yeah. Yeah, thank you. And that's such a wonderful program. When I was at MLC, it was always just such a neat thing that all of a sudden my congregation had blessed me, and that MLC matched whatever my congregation would give me. So it's a wonderful opportunity. Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm. And next Saturday, we're having a celebration or shower for Zachary and Madeline. Everyone's welcome. And Saturday afternoon is an appointment from 4 to 7 p.m. It's going to be at Parsonage in the backyard. So if you have any questions about that or any more information, just feel free to talk to me.
Okay. Any other announcements? I did not. So there's also Sunday school after the service. What time does the Sunday school start at?
Right away.
Just right away. Okay. All righty. Yep. So Sunday school just after the service. So love to have the kids join us for that. Okay. If there's no other announcements, God richly bless your week, and thank you all again for having me this morning.
Hi, I'm Wells President Mark Schrader. It's true that the gospel alone has the power to create and sustain faith in Christ Jesus. It's also true that God asks us to use his gifts of sanctified wisdom and judgment to plan best how to proclaim the gospel in our context. The Wells National Conference on Lutheran Leadership was recently held in Chicago to discuss both of those truths. It brought together 1,300 lay people and called workers to talk about our mission, to share best practices for gospel ministry, and to enjoy Christian fellowship.
I know I don't have all the answers, and I know it's a really good thing to meet with other people that have other ideas.
Things for us to think about, take back to our churches and share. Just good thoughts and ideas.
The Leadership Conference provided the opportunity to talk about some of the major strategic challenges our church body is facing, like retaining our youth.
We have an epidemic of loneliness, and one of the greatest needs that we have right now is that the church really can be a place where people can meet their emotional needs, particularly their loneliness, and find a place where they can find a family that is there to help walk them through their doubts.
But select capable men from all the people.
About half of the attendees of this conference were lay people, and a major focus was how to better use their gifts and insights to do more gospel ministry.
I imagine that most, if not all of you, are serving as some type of leader or working with leaders in your congregations.
We had to lean on our lay leadership to get more involved in our outreach and Bible information class training and teaching. This is a really good idea just in general to broaden the ministry and to share the teaching of the small catechism with people that don't have any background in the Bible.
Lay people can teach the small catechism, We are members of the priesthood of all believers, and what Jesus does empower us through the ministry of keys for us to be able to teach and evangelize.
Another major focus of this conference was the importance of healthy congregational culture. Leaders helping shape how people think about gospel ministry.
And share a time when you experience the impact of an organization's culture.
For example, multiple presentations talked about the need to think about evangelism differently. Not so much as something the congregation does, but as something that we all do. Talking to people about Jesus as God provides us opportunities.
In order for our congregations to do evangelism to the best of their ability, we want to get all of our members involved in evangelism. The culture of a congregation is critical to its health and its ability to serve the people in its community.
Every congregation has a culture, and you're either shaping it or it's shaping you. It matters because it's these shared thought habits we have that just show up. And we might not even realize it gets in the way of us trying to get stuff done. And so if a congregation says, we'd like to be more outreach-minded, and what are the thought habits that kind of get in the way? How do we look at change?
How can we not take that charge and move past the barriers?
Evangelism by everyone and for everyone. The conference included presentations that encouraged attendees to think about how they could better reach out to all people, including individuals from different backgrounds and cultures.
Take a look around the room, a look around your congregation, and if everyone looks the same, thinks the same, and talks the same, particularly when it's not focused on the gospel, because we know that's the one truth, then that's the opportunity to figure out a strategy to reach out.
The presentations discussed the large changes in the Christian landscape in America. Yet, they also stressed that, with the strength and courage Christ provides by His Word, we can look at those changes not so much as challenges, but as opportunities. This is our Lutheran moment.
What I think our world needs most right now happens to line up perfectly with some of the things that we do best as Lutherans. Seems to me that if you pay attention, you open your ears, you open your eyes, you see people raising questions and problems that the things that we know and believe as Lutherans are the perfect solution to. And so I wanted people to be able to see that and be excited about the fact that we have what our moment needs and what our world needs from us.
These topics and the many others covered at the conference were not just for one-time discussion in Chicago. They'll continue to be covered in upcoming Forward in Christ articles, as well as addressed in our Synod's long-range plan called Christ Through Us, which will be outlined at this summer's Synod Convention. You can watch several of the presentations from the conference at LutheranLeadership.com.
Joyful Eastertide, away with sin and sorrow. My love, the crucified, has sprung to life this morrow. Had Christ, who once was slain, not burst his three-day prison, our faith had been in vain. But now is Christ arisen, arisen, arisen. But now is Christ arisen. Death's blood has lost its chill since Jesus crossed the first his 3-day prison, our faith. for a season's slumber. Till Trump from east to west shall wake the dead in number. Had Christ who once was slain, that first his three-day prison, our faith had been in vain. But now is Christ arisen, arisen, arisen. But now is Christ arisen.